Welcome all to the County Commissioners meeting of May 1st. And if you would join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And let us take a moment, please, to remember all the men and women who serve in our armed forces, both here and abroad, and especially for those who have given their lives for us. Thank you. Well, we have a very exciting afternoon, I think, today. We are welcoming three women officials from Pakistan, and they're here under a program that the town administrator from the town of Brewster, Charlie Sumner, is here, and he's the host of this of the group while they're here touring the Cape and wherever else in Massachusetts you are, maybe just here. So I'm going to turn it over to Charlie. And actually, we have a podium over there, but it might be easier if you don't mind speaking from there. And then
we can be more informal with you, though.
Yeah, you don't have to get up to a podium, but it makes it easier for the camera to be able to see, and then for all of us to see. So.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'd like to thank the commissioners for inviting us to this meeting. My name is Charlie Sumner. I'm the town administrator for the town of Brewster. And what is occurring is that the Mass Municipal Association, which is our statewide organization for local governments, has applied for a grant through the United States Department of State. And the purpose of the grant is to bring local officials from Pakistan to the United States. So there are actually, I believe, 14 young Pakistani professionals visiting Massachusetts. They're working and living in five different communities in the Commonwealth. So this is Brewster applied to Mass Municipal Association, was honored to be accepted. So our guests are here for a 9-day period in Brewster. And in the purpose of this program really is for our guests to learn a little bit about how we do business in Massachusetts, and talking about issues of civic engagement and organizational issues and services that we provide to the public. And of course, I've been learning a lot about Pakistan and governmental processes, issues and problems that Pakistan deals with, and some of them are not dissimilar from the issues that we deal with as well. But of the 14 guests that are here from Pakistan, interestingly, 11 of them are women. And so, you know, when you talk about biases, I think my initial feeling was that it may have been a majority of males versus females, but not true. And it's really been a great experience. And they are actually in the United States for a 6-week period. So it involves a number of other educational and training opportunities and then the 2-week program in Massachusetts. And so I think that's essentially the overview that I wanted to make. And I'd certainly love our guests to sort of talk a little bit about their background and experience, because it's rather diverse. And the another interesting thing that I've learned as I've talking about geography and going over maps and reading issues, as they come from very different parts of their country, south, west, north, northwest, and east. And they all have their own issues and problems. It's really been a great experience. And thank you for the county commissioners for giving an overview of what Barnstable County does for all of our member communities.
Okay, well, I'm not sure.
I just have a question. Did you know each other before you came?
No.
Oh, you didn't. So,
you know, I'm not surprised that women are are active, because was it Benazir Bhutto?
Benazir Bhutto.
Was your premier, right? And of course, she was educated here in the United States. Yeah. Matter of fact, in Massachusetts, as I recall. So there was, you know, there is that tradition of supporting women, in the country.
Yes.
Okay. All right, tell us about yourselves.
Well, I think, I thought maybe we start that you can tell us what you do, and then that would help us so that when Mark makes, is going to give you a presentation, a brief presentation of the county government and actually how it works, what our departments are, and then we can have another conversation again. But I think it would help if we could hear from you and what you do back home.
Yeah, of course. I'm with San Aziz, and I'm working in the monitoring and evaluation department in federally administered tribal area, that is called FATA. And I'm living in Peshawar. I'm from Pakistan. So this is, my job is to, I'm monitoring different departments like health, education, infrastructure, dam, roads, and buildings, all those. I monitor their performance.
Are you an engineer?
No, I'm not in general monitoring this.
I see.
But especially education.
Okay.
Okay.
I'm Saima Khatian, and I'm from one of the second largest province, Sindh, from the Pakistan. And I'm from Karachi, actually, biggest city of Sindh mm-hmm. province. And I work with the National Airline, Pakistan International Airline, and I deal with the audit. And I have four divisions of customer services department. I deal with the compliance of internal audit and financial audit and government audit.
Mm. Interesting.
Yeah. I am Shagufta Zari. Professionally, I'm a medical doctor, but later I was inducted in civil service of Pakistan through a rigorous competitive process. Now I'm serving with federal government of Pakistan. Right now I'm working with Federal Board of Review. It's just like yours, FBR, and I am managing IRS, Inland Revenue Service. In Pakistan, taxes are administered federally. Like these have not been, these direct and indirect taxes have not been delegated to the local and provincial government. I am working with income tax, sales tax, that is your VAT, value added tax, and federal excise duty.
Are you looking for ways to expand that to the provinces and to the townships?
Actually, provinces have been given other taxes, like property tax, provincial excise duty on vehicles, mm-hmm. and some other taxes like on water, sewerage, and other things.
Okay.
So a portion of VAT on services, because we are managing VAT on goods, VAT on services has recently been given to the provinces.
I see. Oh,
but a portion of that tax will go to the federal government as well.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
So provinces will get a major share of that, but a small right. share of that will go to federal government.
Do you regulate the electric utility industry?
Sorry?
Do you regulate or do you, is the electric utility industry, is that a national, is that nationalized?
Yes.
Okay, because I used to be involved with the nuclear power industry here, and many of the engineers that I used to, you know, used to deal with were Pakistanis.
Okay.
Yeah, so, you know, I wondered as to whether you have a cottage industry of growing, you know, nuclear engineers over there.
Yes, but nuclear industry is not answerable to FBR.
Ah. Mm-hmm.
It is being managed by Interior Ministry, actually.
Okay.
But we get taxes from all the institutions, from major organizations. I can't exactly point out what portion is being given by the nuclear industry, but for the time being, it's a growing industry in Pakistan. Mm-hmm. But it's more into peace processes, like not for bombing.
No, right. That,
right.
The
yeah,
industry here does the same
and,
thing.
Yeah, and that yeah. sort of thing.
But we
yeah.
are producing a small portion of energy from nuclear power.
Are you also, if I may just follow up on
sure.
that, are you also looking at renewable energies on that line, you know,
right.
wind and?
Right now we have enough resources of renewable energy, but lack of planning is hindering us, so we are not using them properly. We are more dependent on non-renewable resources. So we are importing oil.
Right.
Most of the time we are importing oil and diesel.
Are mm-hmm. you bringing them to the commission?
I hope so.
Okay.
Well, I think the commission
no, they're coming
is
going
to come over. Yeah.
Yeah.
I have a question. When did you learn English? At what point in your life? Not just to come here. Did you learn it?
From the beginning?
English is a compulsory subject in our schools, colleges. In colleges, everything is in English, but in schools, English is a compulsory subject. Apart from that, English, there are two medium of instruction in our education department. One is the national language, Urdu medium, and the other is English medium. So the students who are going for English medium are mostly being educated by the private schools, commercialized schools. Everything is in English. But the one who are going to public schools, these are usually English Urdu medium schools. But again, in that Urdu medium, one subject is compulsory, that is English.
Yeah.
Oh, that's interesting.
It really is the English, I'm learning as I go along, but is the language of government and business.
Most of the time, it is.
Just to touch on revenues a bit, that's a challenge for us here at the county level. I don't know what Charlie's told you about sort of regional government and county government here in Massachusetts, but not too long ago, they eliminated most counties. There's only 6 counties left out of, I think it was 15 at one point in time. So regional government here, really one of the challenges is revenues. We have a revenue stream from a deeds excise tax, when you file a deed at the Registry of Deeds. But other than that, we don't really have a revenue stream. The local governments, as you know, they have property taxes. State, the federal government has the income tax, and state governments have the sales tax. But we don't really have, you know, sort of a revenue stream here except for the deeds tax. And that can fluctuate depending on the economy and how, you know, land transfers are taking place.
You mentioned the VAT. You know, the VAT is collected by a merchant, right? Okay, and the merchant is then responsible for how do you monitor that?
Most of the system is being computerized now. Initially, we had a manual system, but now if they do any sale purchase things, it's already computerized. So we just have an idea. Our software just tell us that he has done this much purchases. But again, when he or she is filing a return for VAT, he or she has to declare everything in that return. And we are going to cross-match that detail with the software, that details of the software that is telling us. But there is lots of mismatch. Sometimes the things are not being computerized, or they have fake and flying invoices for that. So that is leading to tax evasion. Because everything, some departments have done lots of computerization. So any sale purchase by those department is immediately reported to us. But every department has not done that. And sometimes people are purchasing things from unregistered person that is not on tax rolls. Again, that is not being reported to us. So you people, though your revenue stream is not that much smooth, but still you have less tax evaders than us. Okay. A rich man is more tax evaded rather than the middle and the lower man.
We try to distinguish between tax avoidance and tax fraud.
Yeah.
So I'm sure you do the same thing.
Now, how long have you had the VAT? Has it been part of your government for a long time? Or was it, I'm thinking about perhaps some of the influence of the British, you know, from many, many years ago. Did it come from there, or is it something that just evolved?
Actually, VAT was introduced in 1980.
1980?
It was in the name of sales tax on our side.
I see.
Just a year ago, we tried to replace this term with VAT, but that issue was that much politicized that we had to take that term back. Now the same tax is being monitored in the name of sales tax. So it is sales tax on our side, VAT on your side, but the system is same.
I see.
We're going through an interesting process in that the internet sales are not taxed, sales tax, and the state of Massachusetts has been reluctant to go forward on it until they had federal support, and at the end of next month, I think the federal government has a bill in process where they will insist that all internet sales be monitored based upon the state in which they are delivered, so that, you know, the states will recover the money. I'm a member of the National Association of County Officials, and the counties in the rest of the country have more direct governing responsibility, and they've been very concerned about this loss of revenue. In Massachusetts, it's estimated it could be worth almost $1 billion in terms of lost revenue because of internet sales. So this is, you know, I guess the wheels of government do not turn unless there's money to put in to make, you know, to lubricate the wheels. So we're looking for more opportunities to collect the money to provide the services that people seem to demand. I wonder if that's similar in Pakistan.
In a national election that are being conducted next month, revenue and taxes is the biggest issue on agenda of every party.
Yeah. Nobody wants to pay taxes. I noticed in the program outline that the MMA had, is that one of the things that you were looking for when you came here to this country was how to engage the public in things, in everything that government does. How do you get them involved, and how do you get them to really buy into decisions that government officials have to make? So I wonder, what is it like for you? I mean, there's so many millions of people who live, well, not in Pakistan.
Well, there's 193 million people that live in your country, right?
193 million, so that's...
And there are different classes, I would imagine. You know, I was always amazed that in India, the middle class of India is as large as the population of the United States, but they have a billion people. So how do you reach your people?
It's up to the issue, what type of issue it is. But mostly people are reached out through political parties. Like if the government, we don't have local government this time. We had local government till 2008, but new democratic government just abolished that local government ordinance and we had no more local government. Before that, of course, people were participating in all the decisions. But mm-hmm. what happened in the last 4 or 5 years, whenever government decided to do something, like there was a famous case of privatization of few of our big organizations that were national organizations, government decided to privatize those. So people were on the streets, everyone was protesting, everyone was writing in the newspapers. So media actually motivated the people. Our media is very strong, electronic and print media. It motivated the people, and the people were on the streets, on the TV shows, talk shows, and everyone was talking against that. Finally, the deal was almost finalized. People went to the court, and government has to take the decision back. So the people pressurized the government to change the opinion.
Do you think that was a good thing?
We did the right thing.
Good.
We did not want to privatize those.
Yes, and I think that's a good thing.
Yes.
So is there a push among the people in Pakistan from the government to want to privatize services? Or are most of your services provided by the government? You were talking about infrastructure and, just keeping
education.
The roads maintained and building the bridges and all of that. Are those done by government or are they private?
Government.
When I lived in Europe, the roads were, you could forgive your taxes if you were a farmer, for example, and you took responsibility for the road that was abutting your property. Do you have something similar in Pakistan? You know, filling in the potholes, you know, cleaning out the ditches, you know, and things like that. And then you were forgiven some portion of your taxes.
We take it as a right that government has to do this.
Okay, right. All right. Okay.
Yeah, all highways, national or national highways, even the intercity roads, everything is being maintained by the government. Heavy industry is being managed by the government. And hopefully the next government is going to continue that. We are in favor of privatization, but if that privatization is going to benefit us, if just for the sake of money, because government revenue is going down and you are going to sell your multinational organizations or the other big organization just because you want a major chunk of money, and that money is for a short-term purpose, not for a long-term, so we are going to hinder that.
Right. Very good.
Interesting.
Yeah.
Okay. So what are the big debates between the people and their government?
Corruption.
Corruption. Yes.
Yes, that's exactly what this article says.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. It identified of the three candidates, the one that was, they say that Ali Zardari was propelled after the murder of his wife, but he's isolated, ineffective, and he has a reputation for corruption. And it says here that the Nawaz Sharif is the one that's given he supposedly has a 59% share of the of PML,
yes.
And then you've got this
cricket
player.
Yeah, well, let's hear from them.
Yeah, okay.
We can read the magazine.
I would also like to read that.
No, I'll give it to you. Yeah,
thanks.
You may have it.
So, what about the status of women? Where is that? Would you say in your country?
If it is in terms of the ethical side, no, they respect very much. Because I'm a Filipina from that tribal where no female can educate, can give them education. I have 5 sisters and one brother. All of my 5 sisters are educated. Even one did CA and other 2 did MBA. And I am a PhD student. I did MPhil in education. And my another sister is a gynecologist. So now that
trend has
been changed. Now they are
in most of the rural areas, girls are being kept in the houses. They are not allowed to go to be, you know, to get education, and they are not getting admission in these schools. But in the cities, everyone is getting education. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So most of the
it's more progressive.
Yeah.
It's more progressive in the cities. Yeah.
Our society is going through a transition, probably. I can safely claim among all Muslim countries that claim to be Muslim, I'm not talking about the countries that are half Muslim, half secular, but among all Muslim countries, Pakistan is the most liberal and most progressive Muslim country, especially regarding women's rights.
Mm-hmm.
Our women, 33% women representation is necessary in our parliament. It is by constitution.
Oh, very good.
33% seats will go to women without contesting election. So they are nominated for those seats by the parties they are contesting for. So if their parties are like PMLN is going into majority of their women will be the female party parliamentarian. At the same time, they have a right to contest election, general election. So if they get party tickets, they are, or even as an independent candidate, they can go for general election. Then 10% women quota is for civil servants. It has recently been introduced by our former government, not the Democratic one, the government one before that, Musharraf government. Probably this is more than enough for females because they are going through competitive process, getting the seats by competing with other men. At the same time, 10% seat through quota.
Yeah.
And apart from that, in the Western world, I have seen women are fighting for equal rights. Probably in Pakistan, they have more than equal rights.
That's
like
crazy.
We get respects just because we are female, so man should give seat to us. They should stand up and give us seat, and we have the right to sit. We don't carry our weight.
Yeah.
If we have heavy weight, we just wait for men to come and carry our weight.
Those are the things that we lost.
Okay.
That's why I said you
in the
middle. We have equal rights, and we have more than equal.
Inshallah. Yeah, and I think that that is not a. I think that that is something that's probably lacking even in the male psyche. I think that that was a. I don't know if that was a good thing, because it gives a role to men to still be protective and to, which I think is a natural instinct, and that's where a little disconnect.
Yeah.
Do you agree, Chum?
I'm on TV, so yes.
When I travel in Indonesia, when I travel in Indonesia, I was very struck by, you know, I was in a conversation with a professional woman, and I said, you know, I noticed you're not wearing a burqa, you know, and she says, well, it's our choice.
Yes.
Because the in Indonesia, being a large, I guess it, in terms of population,
yeah,
about
biggest,
this,
yeah,
yeah.
Population.
So I came away with the impression that there was an equality that was in fact, you know, present because of, you know, because of hearing that. So apparently Pakistan is the same way. Now, I've not read the Quran in Arabic, but my impression is that women are given equal status in the Quran. And in the beginning, from what I recall, they owned businesses and were able to own property in their own right. So you know that. So I've always said that there's, in my mind, there was sort of a disconnect between what I had read or understood and what I read in magazines or popular press.
Yes.
Even in Quran, in Surah Nisa, they have given, Surah Nisa, Nisa means women. And so they give the right, all the rights, including the property.
Indeed.
Inheritance rights, property rights, everything goes to women.
Yeah.
And apart from that, if I'm earning, it's not my duty to feed my family.
Yeah.
It's my husband's duty.
Yeah.
He's going to finance the family. My salary is only my salary.
Yeah.
I'm going to shop for that.
No, that's what my mother told me.
Yeah.
So,
I think
you know,
I'd like that.
What's,
yeah.
You know,
yeah. Maybe we should see if we're going to retire.
Yeah.
But
all responsibility goes to men, and all perks comes to me.
you must have met my mother, because I remember she told me that.
Yeah. And the last government introduced another ordinance, not ordinance, it issued a notification that the female government servants are going to have compulsorily, if they want it, they're going to have their hometown postings. Hometown means the town of their spouse or their parents' town. But males are not going to have it. They can be posted anywhere in the country. So if I'm serving with federal government, it means I can be posted anywhere in the country.
Mm.
But it's my choice that I want to live in this city. So what has been the outcome of that? All big cities are full of female officers,
yeah,
and all smaller cities, burbs and other things, where no one wants to serve, males have been posted there.
I have another question to go back,
sure,
to your, now that you're, that your issues are being driven by parties.
Yes.
Do you find that that is making it more difficult? And I'll give you why I ask, because here in this country, we've always had, it seemed, a balanced approach between our two parties. There was a, they kind of put each other into check and therefore somehow had to agree upon, you know, there was two different, everybody wants to do the right thing, two different ways of doing it, but to get it done, you had to come to some compromise. And I'm sure you're well aware that that is a much more difficult happening today here, or an occurrence here in the United States. So the more our party system becomes divided, the message becomes tailored to the mission of that party, and not really a national mission. It becomes driven by winning, who's first, who has power, it's our way, we are right, you are wrong, that we've lost somehow the ability to compromise and to see that we're all in this together. Are you finding, or and if you haven't, it's something to keep your eye on, but are you finding that now that parties are driving this, that issues can become distorted and misinformation is more readily available when people are trying to get their message out, as opposed to these parties really working towards truth and factual information to support their arguments?
Under we are government center, we can't speak on all these issues. I mean on political issues.
Right.
We haven't the right to speak on this.
Right.
But I think there are every party claims that they are doing this, they are doing this for your. But in fact, right now we have the ideas that maybe the Imran Khan party, like Tehreek Insaf, do something well for direct, I mean, they are very close or near to the transparency in the entire country.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe they do some good for the people from the base, from the roots, like you are, the work of yours, like town meetings, yeah, or town managers. I'm very much like this because they are working with the on the ground realities. They know each and everything. On top, they don't know. On the bottom, you know each and everything. So this is the party motive, I think, the Imran Khan, Tehreek Insaf. Maybe he do something for...
We are hoping for the best.
Yeah.
So, we all hope
and
for
I
the
hope
best.
We all hope for the best for you and for us.
Now,
actually, you people trust your parties and their stance.
Yeah.
We don't trust our parties.
Yeah, no.
We don't see the world through their prism.
That's
we have our own eyes.
Yeah.
So we three parties are contesting. Two have already been in power, so we have tested them enough. Imran Khan's party is contesting first time, so we have pinned some more hopes to him.
Maybe.
That probably he will do some miracles.
Yeah.
I have a question. You know, I'm sure Charlie's talked about sort of some of the challenges facing governments here in the United States, and especially Massachusetts. Two of the biggest are pension, local pension costs, and health care. How do you guys deal with those two things, like retirement and retirement security and health care, if you have to go to the hospital for something major? How do you deal with that?
Luckily, these are not big issues on our side.
Yeah.
Pension, all government servants are entitled for a particular amount of pension, and they are going to get that.
Mm-hmm.
There is no obstacle in that. Every month when you are getting your salary, some portion of that is being deducted in the name of your after-retirement funds,
mm-hmm,
gratuity fund or some benevolent fund and other things. So after your retirement, you are going to get that. Government never ever deducts any money from that. Rather, every year government has to increase some pension amount because it's taken as a right for them.
Can I just ask you, is that managed at the federal level or the local level?
Every level.
Depends on what you're in.
Yeah, depends which government you are serving for. And regarding health care, we have large number of hospitals, but unfortunately, most of the big hospitals are located in big cities.
Mm-hmm.
So people from smaller cities have to travel to that city. Public hospitals are offering all types of treatments, but you have to stand in a long queue for that.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that you have to get an insurance card, healthcare card. Nothing is required for that. You can get access to any public hospitals. You have to wait in the long queue. By the time your turn comes, whatever your problem is, doctors are going to take care of that. Our healthcare system is quite smooth in that regard, that we don't charge enough money. You people have to pay for your healthcare insurance and other things. Our people don't have to pay for that. Mm-hmm. They just have to pay for the bills that are going to be given to them at the time of operation or treatment. And they have to get their medicine on their own.
Which is a portion of whatever the total cost is what you're saying.
Public hospitals give a subsidized, they shift a subsidized cost to the patients. Right. But if the surgery is the major one, then problem comes. Mm-hmm. It's costing them a lot, but again, a portion of that is being shifted to a poor patient. Mm-hmm. At that time, government has some more funds for that. It's like donations, we call it zakat and other things. So that should be managed by that, but sometimes if the number of patients is more and we don't have enough donations at the time, patient has to bear that burden. But at the same time, we have another system that is the privately run hospitals, and these are the expensive ones. Mm-hmm. They are offering very good treatment with a nice protocol and other standard, but only elite class can afford
right,
that.
Yeah.
And even if you are a government servant and pensioner, you can get free
healthcare after retirement.
After retirement from the concerned hospital.
Mm-hmm. We're dealing with a man in Egypt who had the free access to free care, but he also bought, catastrophic support insurance, and that so he had care to a certain level that might be identified as being mediocre, but okay. But then if he wanted to get that extra piece, he had to buy private insurance to do that. So it meant that his income had to be at a certain level in order to be able to afford that. Is that a practice in Pakistan as well?
No, it's not.
Okay.
Being a government servant, we are declared as entitled for certain hospitals. Like if I'm serving in a federal government in that city, then that hospital has, I have entitlement for a particular hospital. I have to go to that hospital and I have a card issued for that. That is not health insurance card, actually it's my employee card. But that hospital has already verified my card, that I am a federal government employee and I am entitled for this hospital. So I have to just show that card. Whatever the cost is, government is going to take that burden.
Where do they get their money? It seems like it's an increasing amount of money that's going out. Where's the money coming from to support it?
Taxes.
So what would someone that would have what I'd call a middle class income, what percentage of the money that they make goes to taxes?
Depends if they are taxpayer or tax evader.
Here lies the corruption, right?
If they're a taxpayer,
then depends upon their income. There is a progressive system of taxation. There is no flat rate for that.
Mm.
We have flat rate only for corporate sector. For non-corporate, for individuals and association of person, we have progressive rate of tax, like up to 3 million, not 0.3 million is free of tax. So the people who are below this range are not required to pay any taxes. If people are crossing this range, then there is a specific tax rate. We have to calculate that for them.
Mm-hmm. Are there exemptions?
There are lots of exemptions depending upon the type of business you are going to do.
Okay. Our children, if you have a child, they used to give you a benefit on your taxes for that. In other words, in addition to an exemption, they would give you a payment. Do they have anything like that in Pakistan?
If you narrate some special incidents, then I can tell you, because we don't have any general category for that.
Okay, so this was just for a live birth of a healthy child.
Why don't we let them ask us some questions?
Yes, I know. They're here to learn from us.
Yeah, we're learning from you, but you came to learn from us.
We are happy to answer about our country.
I'm sure you are, and we're happy to hear it too.
Another major purpose of this MMA program is a cultural exchange, bilateral exchange process. You are going to learn from us, and we are going to learn lots of things from you.
Yes, hopefully.
All the time we are teasing Charlie and his wife.
Oh, yes. And having a wonderful time.
We ended up with a good group. We ended up with a very good host.
Why don't we break for just a minute and have Mark give the overview of the county government, and then you can ask
discuss a lot of questions. And we also have a few of our department heads here, so I don't know if they have to go.
Do we have enough time?
Yes, we do. But I was just going to say, I was negligent because Sue Levin is here.
Is here, yes.
Sue is our town planner. They're going to be meeting with Sue and talking about permitting, but I also really wanted to talk about regional wastewater issues.
And Patty's in the background, too. She came in just a few minutes after you guys came in.
And Patty Daly from the Cape Cod Commission is here.
So I just wanted to welcome Sue, because she'd be mad at me otherwise.
Well, why don't we welcome the people who are here? If you, in the very back row, why don't you, each of you, stand up and introduce yourselves so they can know who you are?
Sure. Hi, I'm Patty Daly. I'm the Deputy Director of the Cape Cod Commission, and we do land use planning and regulate development.
I'm Sean O'Brien, and I'm the Emergency Preparedness Coordinator for Barnstable County. And I also work out of the Department of Health and Environment. So we're based out of a county health department. We're the only county health department in New England. And we offer a lot of different services to the 15 towns here in Barnstable County.
Good afternoon and welcome. Bill Clark, I'm Director of the Cape Cod Cooperative Extension with the Educational Department of the county. And happy to share all the services we provide.
Yes. And then we have two citizens with us today. They usually attend our meetings.
Yes.
Pat and Dick Andres, and we're citizens.
Yeah. Right. And in the back, we have representative of the media.
Jim.
I mean.
Yes.
Yeah. And then we have our, she's the clerk who's taking the minutes of our meeting. And her name is
Justina.
Right.
Justina.
She puts all this fine stuff together for us.
Okay, so Mark, you're going to do
that. Okay, I'm going to do the. I have to go over here. I do have some copies of the presentations. Let me just leave three with the commissioners, and then you guys can pass them out if you would. Take one and pass it out. And I'm going to run through this very fast. Okay. Yeah. Sure.
What?
So. I have to come over here and just drive a little bit. So what I was going to do is just give you an overview of the regional government here on Cape Cod on in Barnstable County. And you'll hear that name interchangeably. Barnstable County and Cape Cod, both essentially for our purposes, the same thing. And hopefully Charlie sort of running you through the geology and the geography and all of that fun stuff.
That was at 8:30 this morning.
Excellent, good. So there's going to be a test
You're being
at the
tested.
End. and then those are, happen to be the three departments that we have here. And I know Charlie wants to sort of focus on the planning piece as well. So maybe after I'm done, we can have Patty come up. And I know she has a little presentation. This is United States and state and local government 101. We have the various layers of government, as you know. Local government here in Massachusetts is very strong. They have the ability to do home rule petitions at our state legislature, which basically means anything that the state isn't charged with doing in the state constitution, a local government can do. But we have this fourth form here in Massachusetts, regional government, but it sort of varies in form. It doesn't really exist in all of our locales here in Massachusetts, and it varies in function. And I think the commissioners had said earlier that we're the regional government in Massachusetts that probably does the most in terms of offering services both directly to citizens and to our and to our local towns, our 15 local towns. So we're pretty proud of that. These are some background on our regional government. We have been affirmed by the voters several times in terms of our charter, our constitutional document, if you will. We've been to the voters a number of times, and they've approved the charter and what we're doing here. We do have a charter system. It establishes, I did talk about the dedicated revenue stream for us through the deeds tax. Most other regional governments in the state, such as they are, don't have that, so we're unique in that fashion, and that gives us a lot of opportunity to do additional services because it brings in some money. And our charter provides a broad language for doing, you know, regional services. We can do a lot of things without having to go back to the state legislature, which really controls our existence and the town's existence and what they can do. Also, we have the Cape Cod Commission Act, which established the Cape Cod Commission, which is really a regulatory agency. More recently, we are trying to create that
recreated as a service agency to provide planning services to the towns. A lot of issues that we're trying to deal with, wastewater being one of the biggest ones, if not the single biggest one. So you'll hear more about that. That has an established dedicated revenue stream too, in the form of an assessment to each of the town on Cape Cod. And we have an executive and legislative branch. You see the executive branch here, the county commissioners. We also have a 15-member assembly of delegates that acts as our legislative branch. They're actually voting on the budget today. It'll be really exciting at 4 o'clock. I don't know if you're going to stay around for that, but that should be awful exciting.
Yes, so
hopefully they'll deal with our budget today. These are some of the departments that we have at the here in the county. I talked about the assembly delegates, county commissioners. I'm not going to go over them. You'll hear more about others. I will mention AmeriCorps Cape Cod, which is a terrific program here. In the United States, there's a program called AmeriCorps, and it's really a volunteer program. Young people get the chance to sign up. They get a small stipend, and they get the opportunity to do different types of things. Here on Cape Cod, the AmeriCorps program is geared towards environmental programs. So they go out, we have 26 kids. They call them kids, but they're really young adults who are residential. There's 13 out in Wellfleet, there's 13 in Bourne, and they volunteer to do different services for the towns, and then they have collective services that they do. It's a really a terrific program, and hopefully later you'll get the chance to hear more about that.
Oh, I was gonna say, Mark, because they did a project in Brewster just recently, and maybe Charlie, if you were down to the beach, you would have seen the project they did.
Yeah, one of our you're gonna be meeting with Chris Miller next week, I believe. And Chris is going to go over some of these projects. Yeah.
The other thing, some other departments that we have in Cape Cod or other functions that we're doing here at the regional government. Cape Light Compact, one of the things that over the past 10 years that have really become more important is this whole energy issue and trying to do renewable energy, trying to do energy efficiency. Electricity costs, especially in Cape Cod, are very high. And it's presented a challenge for economic development, for local governments paying the bills, those types of things. So we've really focused attention on that over the past 10 years. In 97, the state deregulated the utility industry. That was sort of the precursor of all this and the prompter to do this. So we've spent a lot of time, a lot of energy, and a lot of resources on trying to do renewable energy and energy efficiency here on Cape Cod. I think we've been very successful with that. We have a dredge program that we have a lot of harbors on the Cape. Unfortunately, Brewster doesn't need that service, but I'll talk about it anyways. We do a lot of dredging to make sure the harbors are open on the Cape. Recreational boating, as you can imagine, on Cape Cod is a big industry, and it pays quite a bit of the bills for the towns as well.
And speaking of dredging, right now Hyannis Harbor, where the steamships and the private ferries run to Nantucket, because of the storm that we just had, Nemo, the harbor now is all full of sand, and I think one of the ferries or one of the boats that kind of landed on the sand and had to wait for the tide to come back in to lift it so it could get out. So dredging is really important here in the Cape.
So the other kind of thing we have a fire training academy where we teach firefighters how to do their jobs better. They practice rescue things. We have some props set up. They practice rescue. They practice, going into confined spaces, those types of things. We do that for the region as well. So what are the benefits of regional services? Well, we think the biggest benefit that we bring is we were able to save money for citizens and towns. And in Massachusetts, at the local level here in Cape Cod, in the U.S. as a whole, spending less on government has been a big issue over the past 30 years or so. It's been maybe the central sort of focus on government is doing more with less, spending less in taxes, those kinds of things. So that's what we think we do. And I mentioned the energy efficiency programs. Through our resource development office, we have a grant service. They monitor grants, but they also apply for grants. We get monies from other government agencies to do the things down here, bring money down. And we do things through the Health and Environment Department, like the health agent services. It's easy, it's more efficient to do it through a regional entity than it is to do it at the local level. There's economies of scale for service delivery, the dredging service that I mentioned. And also through the REPC, which you'll hear about from Sean, it really encourages a dialogue between towns and the regional government and entities that sometimes, for lack of a better word, have a distrust of each other or maybe don't see eye to eye all the time, such as in the Regional Emergency Planning Committee. We brought together police, fire, health, boards of health, all different agencies to sort of coordinate a better response to emergencies that occur on Cape Cod, like hurricanes or those types of things. There's challenges. These are some of the challenges. I'm sure you can relate to these. Financing, revenues, and money is always an issue. We've just gone through a period where our budget had actually gone down several million dollars. We have about a we have about a $25 million budget. A few years ago, it was $28 million, so we faced that. We were able to do it really by cutting some corners here and there, but not reducing services, so that's a challenge. Doing more on a regional basis is a challenge. It's really hard to identify and deliver the services that the towns need and want. That's really a challenge. And especially putting together sort of the critical mass. You may have one town that wants to do it, but the other 14 aren't interested, so it's really hard to develop sort of an efficient system sometimes. Developing a support system for regional government services, that's a constant challenge. Engaging the public, making them aware of sort of what the regional government is and does, that's a constant challenge. And, you know, sort of, I guess, government engagement. You were here for a special election that the state just had. And you probably heard about it in the paper. Not many people showed up. And that's for a U.S. senator position. It's a pretty important position. So it's government engagement is really a hard thing to do overall. And that goes along with sort of the public awareness. So these are some of the other issues that we have facing us. Wastewater right now is always at the top of everybody's list in terms of issues facing the region. Human services is a challenge for us. There's less money going towards human services. Affordable housing is an issue here in Cape Cod. Housing is typically very expensive here. Transportation is an issue. Bill can talk more about that. And homelessness is an issue. We have that issue in trying to coordinate services for people who end up unfortunately homeless. So there, now I think I will, the rest of the presentation really sort of deals with specifics for each of the service areas here. So what I think I will do is conclude here and maybe turn it over, Madam Chair, if that's all right, to Patty, and you can sort of focus on that. And Charlie, if that's okay with you too. Almost looks like we know what we're doing, huh?
So far, you have me fooled.
In your country's telephones, we observed that in Europe, right, and in parts of Asia, that cell phones have been the communication device of choice, and the investment in infrastructure for landlines has gone down. And is this something you've noticed as far as reducing the impact of cost on government for putting in permanent phone lines?
I think in the federal ministry, there is often a problem of net services. The telephone services are also related to these services. So I think they have a great impact because every person has a mobile phone, even housekeepers or
servants
have two or three mobiles on their pockets and they are giving some cleaning or something else, two mobiles on their hand, okay, hello, just made it. They give that kind of service, so it's a definite impact on the government side. So often I also prefer to call on mobile instead of rather I call on telephone.
The National Telecommunication Service has been privatized by Musharraf government, but at the same time, he just issued another ordinance that made that competition very tough among the cellular services network. lots of investment has been done on cellular services, but not by the government, it's by the private sector. The result of that competition is we are getting very, very low rate of calls on cellular, on cell calls. So it's easier for us to call each other with lots of bundle packages for texts and calls on cell rather than using our landlines or others.
Thank you.
It was my first instance, like, I found it very difficult to get SIM here in the US. In Pakistan, within no minutes, you can get a SIM if you present your identification card or your passport.
And you have many choices, like, there are many networks. So you can take of your choice.
And they are working even in the far-flung areas of Pakistan, even in rural areas where you won't find any other facility, but cell network will work over there.
So I think it's very good for us because it is communicating, we are communicating very easily. Like someone is living in a rural area and we are in urban cities, they can communicate, they can have any problem, like health difficulty or medical emergency, so they can communicate and reach the destination very quickly.
Only problem is in the
fertile
area, otherwise
the
rural area is.
Okay, Patty.
Thank you for the opportunity. Patty Daly, so the Cape Cod Commission is, as I said, we're a planning and regulatory agency. Back starting around the 1960s, Cape Cod really started to grow. We saw a lot of development. I think some of that had to do with President Kennedy, who had a home in Hyannisport. Cape Cod became very well known then. And so through the 60s and 70s, and especially around the 80s, we saw lots of development happening around the Cape. And people became rather alarmed because we have a very fragile environment. We're surrounded by water. We have over 1,000 freshwater ponds, lots of wetlands, and the response to that alarm was to create the Cape Cod Commission. So the Cape Cod Commission Act was to ensure that any development that occurred here was coordinated and appropriate for the environment, and also that we had a balanced economy going forward. So the Commission Act was created by an act of the state legislature, and it was ratified by a vote of the county residents in a referendum vote. And our mission statement is to protect the unique values and quality of life on the Cape by coordinating a balanced relationship between economic development and environmental protection. More recently, we do work in traditional areas like water quality, particularly wastewater, which I'll talk about, transportation planning, solid waste. But more recently, we've gotten involved more in technology and data. So collecting data and trying to format it in ways that it's more useful to our member towns and to the residents of the Cape and to the business community as well. One of the big efforts that we're doing with our technology effort now is called the Watershed MVP, and MVP stands for Multivariate Planner. And we're really proud of this. This is something we've developed that'll be available on the internet for anybody to use. And it allows folks to choose any number of parcels. It could be a neighborhood, it could be a watershed, and apply different treatment methods to for wastewater in that area. And the tool will tell you how much that would cost and how much nitrogen you're removing from the system when you use a particular technology. So in this way, we hope that the towns and the residents can quickly and easily understand what some of our options are for dealing with our wastewater problems here. We are looking countywide at a bill of potentially $4 billion to $8 billion, six maybe, at the high end, so it's a lot of money, but we have to do this in order to protect our water quality and our marine embayments. Do you guys know what watersheds are? Right?
We do.
Yeah. Another technical project we're working on is electronic permitting, and I know Sue's going to talk about permitting as well, perhaps, but this is a program the state gave us a big grant to develop online permitting for local government. So I know we've been working with our local home builders and local contractors, and they're very interested in this. They would not have to go to town hall to pull permits anymore. They could be at home on the computer anytime, night or day, apply for the permit, pay for it, watch how it's tracking through the system at the local level. Same for homeowners that are pulling permits as well. So it really, it's very efficient. It makes the level of service much better for the end users. And it also creates a lot of efficiency so that town employees aren't having to re-enter information like at every step of the way. That information follows the permit through the local departments, and it's always visible to the contractor or the end user. Viper is a program that we worked on. It basically tells fire personnel if there are any environmental sensitive issues going on when they're responding to a fire. So if there's an environmental resource in the area where they're responding, they would know that and they might adjust how they fight the fire in that instance. Using water versus a chemical application, for example. And Stats Cape Cod is all kinds of just demographic and economic data about the region that's available, again, for residents, businesses. People thinking about locating a business here can learn very much about the Cape through our Stats Cape Cod project, available online, of course. So water quality management, this is the biggie, as we said. you can see the blue and gray blobs are the watersheds. The kind of light yellow are the town lines. So the 15 town lines are in the light lines there. And what this map shows is that 2/3 of our watersheds cross town lines. However, the way the federal, state, and regulatory system is set up for planning and funding, it's up to the towns to plan for wastewater management. So with having all of these watersheds crossing town lines, it's been a challenge for towns to work together with each other. Some are at different stages in their planning than others. So we're actually embarking on a region-wide plan that we'll be starting into very soon to especially look at some of these shared watersheds and work with the towns to identify some solutions for our wastewater issues going ahead. We're looking, as I said, at targeted watershed solutions. We're looking at not only traditional sewers and cluster systems, but using plants, for example, to take nitrogen out of the system in a way that's much more sustainable and environmentally advantageous. And we're also looking at, and we're hoping that these decentralized and innovative approaches may be a lot less costly than just a typical traditional sewer system. And we intend over the next 12 months to have a very robust public engagement process where we pull together the citizens on a watershed basis and work through options with them with that watershed MVP I showed you. So you can have a back and forth discussion with the citizens and say, you know, if we do this, this is what that looks like. If we do something else, that's what that looks like. And hope to come to some consensus through that process. Economic development, we look to work with towns to identify kind of smarter ways to grow. When a lot of the towns did their zoning some time ago, it was sort of broad brush, and it kind of moved away from the village center type development that happened here a long time ago. So we're trying to sort of pull development back in and draw bright lines around where we'd like to encourage it or not. And that's Route 28 in Yarmouth, some work we did there. Streetscapes, designing walkable, bikeable places, connecting people and information. We have a comprehensive development, economic development strategy that's been approved by the federal government and worked on by many people in the Cape, including our Chamber of Commerce and Technology Council and commissioners. And so we've had broad participation in that. And working to revitalize our historic areas and resources.
The goal, Charlie, is to get every place to look like Brewster.
Yeah. Now they're making fun of me.
Yeah,
Transportation, you know, it's integral to a lot of what we do. So we do a lot of traffic analysis, engineering. We look at roadway segments and intersections, a lot of bicycle and pedestrian planning we're doing right now. And we count traffic, and some of that data goes back into our data warehouse so, you know, people can understand how roadway systems work or might impact economic growth. And natural resources, so we are in charge of protecting wetlands. I mentioned we have over 1,000 freshwater ponds, woodlands, and wildlife habitats. So we do our best to help protect those excellent resources. And our logo is keeping a special place special.
So do you have questions for Patty?
No, on some of
yeah,
those.
I have
you want? Sure, go ahead. You don't mind, Patty.
No, that's fine. Being a planning person, one thing is most important in planning data, exact data, accurate data. You know, how do you know that this data is accurate? Or how do you, I mean, you can say that this data is very good or exact data so that I can make planning on the basis of this?
No, that's a great question. You know, we don't live in a perfect world, so obviously that can be an issue. One thing we've learned over the past several years, we've really dived into this data issue, is that if you can take the data you've got and break it down to its most elemental pieces, call it atomic data, then it's then you make it available for combinations with more other things. So if you've got your data grouped together, it only kind of serves one purpose. But if you can break it down, then you start seeing other ways you can use those smaller pieces of data, which I thought was really fascinating. And sometimes, you know, we go with the best information we have, and we put it out there, and we explain our assumptions and the limitations, and we ask the public to help us make it better. So it's an iterative process where you you put it out, you identify that you understand it's not perfect, but over time you can polish it up and make it better.
Patty, there's a big effort over the Cape Cod Commissioners, I understand it, to accumulate the acquired data and put it in a manageable form.
Yes.
So that would help to self-verify, you know, some of the collection activity that goes on. All three of us have served as members of the Cape Cod Commission and participated in, you know, in the plan as part of the planning process, and it's sort of the, you know, one of the extra responsibilities we have as commissioners to, you know, to see, to be part of that.
Yeah, because in our country most of the problem is that if the data is biased, so the planning cannot be planning and policy cannot be a good. If the policy is made, then the implementation power, then, when there is a question of implementation, that there is one. If they either they like the policy, but they can't implement, like in the way.
It's a political piece to data verification, because what I've found is that the so-called peer review process, which is supposed to be a, you know, a method by which you would verify the validity of data, has a political cast, because if you pick those peers that are friendly to you and your data, you tend to have a response that supports that, and if the other side picks peers, then it goes out the opposite. Patty's boss, Paul, has described some of the issues that we face of being that you get what I'd call acceptance at a at a level of academic and technical, you know, application, and then you get a an acceptance of need, and then we send the bill. And then at that point, then all of these other questions come up about, have you looked at this way or that way or the other thing. Now, anybody, and I'm sure this goes on in Pakistan, you reach a point where you have to build something, and you have to go forward with what you know, and that's what the Cape Cod Commission
does. Well, that's the important. I was going to say, you sort of hit the nail on the head. You can wait for perfect data, but you're never going to get it. So part of it is really a public education and engagement campaign where you explain to them, this is how you did it, this is... And the longer you wait to sort of make your decision, the more expensive the decision gets to implement. So you have to strike this balance where you have to finally decide to do something.
And a great example of that was in the wastewater area. where we had some scientists from UMass Dartmouth do studies on the watersheds and the bays to see how much nitrogen. They call them total maximum daily loads, TMDLs, of nitrogen. And the scientists did this in many of the harbors and many of the waterways and the watersheds and the ponds and so forth in all the towns on the Cape. Well, some people challenged that, and they didn't believe it. And you know, so you had to say, well, it's the best data you have. It's better than not having anything. And probably it will change. In another month, the data could be totally different if it were taken at a different time of the year. Mm-hmm. So the idea is kind of convincing people to work with what you have, monitor it, and then if it changes, then adapt the changes, but don't just throw it out. And I think we learned that lesson really well with the TMDLs.
And this kind of goes back to where, you know, where there's divisions, you know, in here, sometimes, you know, people, and with the internet's a wonderful thing, and yet it can be a dangerous thing, because now the public feels as though they have so much information, they feel almost expert on situations. So therefore, they know the answer, or they know that the answer isn't your answer. And they don't like your answer because your answer is going to cost money, where my answer is not going to cost me anything. So they don't believe your data. And just by actually questioning that data makes other people question it too, whereas if it is the data, and yes, it could change probably for the worse as time goes on, which will be more costly, you're in a yes, no, I said this, and who is right? So it becomes very, it creates a lot of stagnation and division and non-production. There's no progress forward. And that is, and a very small group of people can do this because they have a very loud voice and they are very active in making sure their voice is heard, whereas most people will go on with their day and they'll say, okay, I accept that, but then let themselves become confused as the opposition gains some ground. So it's a very, you know, democracy is a wonderful thing, but it has its...
You no doubt have been to a carnival where they beat the drum to get you inside the tent. Yes. And my father had always told me, the louder they beat the drum, the worse the show is inside. So a lot of this, you know, is the same thing.
Yeah, it's very much that.
Yeah. Anyway, any other questions for Patty? Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Okay, Patty.
Thanks, Patty.
And Patty is available, and as is anybody in her team, if you wanted to go over there before you leave. It's a great group, and they do wonderful things, so it'd be a great learning experience.
And by the way, Sue Levin has wonderful, it can give you wonderful insight as to what goes on in planning. She did work for my town before she went to work for the Brewster. Yes. I live next door to Brewster in Harwich.
She knows
if you come up 124 to go to Charlie's house, you go by my
Brewster
house.
Brewster pays better.
Yeah. Bill Clark.
Bill Clark's going to get going. Come on, Bill.
Come up here, Bill.
And then I use
a Macintosh. I hope this
works. Oh, yeah, without frying my computer. Yeah, you found it. Maybe you have it wrong side up, though.
There we go.
Oh, you know what you're doing, so you're all set. Just click on open the font folder.
I think it's the one that's highlighted.
Yeah.
Oh, you got to keep that coming.
All right, now what I do, Mark?
Got all his financial.
What are you looking for, the file, Bill, or what?
Yeah.
He had it there a second ago, but yeah.
I'll send Mark right over.
Wait, I have to put on my IT hat.
So while Bill is loading that up, so what you'll see next week in Brewster's case.
I'm trying to get rid of all the other stuff that was on there.
So is it
working on our comprehensive water planning effort, and we're going to work cooperatively with the Cape Cod Commission to identify our problems, our solutions. And work as a team. So Sue's going to take what Patty just provided and apply it locally.
So it should be.
And use that MVP planner.
Yeah.
So go into your...
How do you like that?
Education.
Yeah, click, double click that.
Hopefully it'll come right up. I'm right, you're not right. We're not saying we're right, we're just saying this is what it says.
Well, and of course, the big issue is too, if people don't believe in the data, and you're using it to spend millions of dollars to either build some type of a system, whether it's, you know, buying eco toilets for everybody or putting in a sewer system, you're using that data to spend a lot of money, so people worry about that.
Well, so of course, Brewster's a little bit behind the schedule, so we're learning from others, really. Our delay at least allows us to see what happens
what's
in other communities
exactly.
And take
yeah.
some of their experiences and try to improve them.
To New Orleans and Eastern Boston.
Okay, Bill, the floor is yours.
Thank you, and again, welcome. I was out for the last couple of days, and I just found out this morning I was putting this together, so I'm using an older version of a presentation. It's longer, so I'm going to quickly go through it.
Okay.
Should you have questions anywhere, just speak up. Okay, first of all, Cape Cod Cooperative Extension, we're a county department, and the name might sound interesting to you, cooperative meaning there's three levels of government. We're county employees, and it's the county department. We're funded by state and federal funds. We have some direct federal money, as well as state money, as well as some grants, federal grants. And just a little bit of history, Cooperative Extension actually started way back with our 16th president, Abraham Lincoln, felt that our country would be stronger if we had a good, strong base in agricultural and mechanical sciences. So he established a land grant university system. Every state in the United States has a land grant university. And the university established, actually federal government, the Congress and the president at the time, gave each state land and funds to establish a university that was established to teach agricultural and mechanical sciences. Actually, we just had our 150th anniversary. It was established in 1863. I was on campus last Thursday for a celebration of this 150th anniversary. So it all started then. They were teaching and conducting research on campus. But in 1914, it was decided by Congress and our president at the time that the teaching and the research was happening on campus, but it should be extended to the real world. So they extended that information from the university to the people in the counties through cooperative extension. So it's a cooperative effort to get the information to the people. So
wait, we have to ask him, who was president in 1914? I told him there was going to be a test. I was going to say,
Wilson. I don't know.
Because well, I wouldn't know.
I don't know who was going to ask. I don't really
know. The first six.
Charlie would know.
And the last six.
What do you say?
I'm going with
Wilson.
Wilson,
Harding,
Wilson, Harding, and then Coolidge. Oh, remember, okay, that Coolidge became president after Harding died.
Okay, our program is based on several topics, and I'll cover each of these in general terms.
Who's there?
But,
I said your name's there.
You have a flyer describing the department in the handouts you're getting. All of the programs, we run educational programs. We provide technical assistance to public officials as well as the industry and the general public, and we conduct applied research. So first, in the horticulture and agricultural part, we work with all the green industries, agriculture, all the farmers in the Cape, anyone that works with growing plants, anything in the green fields, not only with the culture of those products, but the pest management. And I'll talk more about that. We work with Lyme disease and deer tick research, and we provide a service to the Master Guard. These are trained volunteers who provide information to the general public. So green industries, educational programs, integrated pest management information, technical assistance, and we also run a nursery. The county owns a 100-acre farm up the street. We lease it to a grower at this point, an organic farmer. 2 acres of that farm we held on to, and it's not leased, we held on to raise trees for the towns.
We have a variety of low-maintenance trees that are known to be insect and disease-free. They're available to the towns for their municipal projects, schools, town hall, libraries, street trees. They're ornamental, they're shade trees. We have a dedicated fund that provides, it's a rotating fund that we're able to provide these trees to the municipalities at a very low cost, below wholesale cost. Labor force is actually happening as we speak. The AmeriCorps members, our volunteers in the Cape, provide help to plant these and maintain these trees. We have a problem in the Cape with, or in this region, not just the Cape, but some parts of the United States, with deer ticks carrying Lyme disease and actually two other common diseases, babesiosis and anaplasmosis. And so we have an educational program to educate the public about how to prevent Lyme disease and how to do tick checks. We have a surveillance program where we collect ticks, test them, and determine what percent are carrying diseases. And we do have an intervention program. So here's the intervention program. Deer ticks are called deer tick because they're the last stage of their life cycle. They reproduce on a large mammal like a deer. And primarily, deer is the host for their reproductive cycle. So we feed the deer corn in strategic locations. And as the deer is going into the, this is a bin filled of corn, whoops, right here. And notice these rollers are impregnated with a pesticide. So when the deer sticks its head in to get food, they wipe up against the pesticide, and it kills the ticks on the deer. So each deer tick can, each female can lay about 3,000 eggs. And if there are several thousand ticks on a deer, then we can reduce the population. This is a project we're working on with the US EPA. And again, as I mentioned earlier, we have information through to gardeners on food production and other horticultural topics, as well as children. And these people are trained volunteers that provide the information to the general public. We don't have the time to provide the information to the public, so we train volunteers and then they extend the information to the volunteers.
You have a community garden in Brewster.
Mm. Yes, actually, one of them in Brewster is where we have the children's garden.
Yeah.
Yes.
Is Dave Rogers?
Yes, yeah, he's one of our master.
He's my neighbor.
Yeah. Is that right? Oh, beautiful spot down there. Yeah. Let's see, where was I? Okay. So that's it. One quick thing. I guess globally, we're looking at, I just heard this the other day, by the year 2050, which is not far away. My grandchildren will be in their 30s at that point. And we're looking at something like 7.5 billion people on our planet. To feed that number of people, we need another planet. And I'm not aware of another planet coming along in the near future. So we need to think big about not only food production more efficiently, pest management, and water. One of our professors at the university is working with Indians in a problem with arsenic in rice. They used to be able to drill wells 300 feet deep to water their fields. Now they're going down 3,000 feet. And as a result, they're pulling up a lot more arsenic. There's more arsenic in rice. And arsenic, obviously, is not good for your nutrition. So there's a major problem there. So there's a lot of problems like that. Not only are we working here locally, but looking at this internationally. Nutrition and food safety, we have one full-time and one part-time position where individuals work with their registered dietitians, working with family nutrition programs, the county wellness program. We provide training for our restaurants and food handlers. There's a requirement in Massachusetts that every food establishment have a certified person on staff who's taken a test and a class on food handling. And we run that test, that program, and give that test. So we have a number of nutrition programs going. And the Barnstable County Wellness Program, we work with our county health department on that project. And school wellness programs. We work with all the municipalities in the Cape, and obviously the people that live here, on household hazardous wastes.
We all generate hazardous materials, and at the end of the day, what do you do with them? So we provide opportunities. I think we have 22 collections this year, coordinated throughout all the towns, where individuals can bring their hazardous waste to their municipal land, their transfer station, and we'll transport them and work out an arrangement with the towns. Actually, we go out to bid to get the best price for collecting materials and disposing of it properly. And we also pick up used needles and sharps at every town in the Cape. We have a site where a person is using needles for diabetes or some other medical reason, they have a place to dispose of them properly. We don't want them in the waste stream. And mercury education and reduction, we collect mercury, we want to keep that out of the waste stream as well. Every year, last year for example, we picked up about 130 pounds of elemental mercury. And a little thermometer has just a few grams in it, so you can imagine how many thermometers we picked up. working with youth, we have the 4-H program. 4-H is working with children. We have a lot of volunteer leaders that work with clubs. This is a subject matter is involved, which attracts the children, but we teach them life skills, leadership skills, civic engagement, and community services. After-school enrichment programs for children. A lot of kids now, unfortunately, both parents have to work, so a lot of kids go home to an empty home, so we're able to provide a lot of opportunities for the children in after-school settings. Natural resources, we provide work with all the towns on municipal projects. We have a competitive grant program if a town is interested in submitting an application to manage a part of their town. They have a project they want to have funded. We'll look at that as a possibility and provide some funding for them to manage their properties. We also work with all the municipalities on wildfire management. We're at great risk for fires. We have a lot of open space, and if it's not managed properly, it becomes fuel. So we provide that training for the firefighters and for the town officials, and we also have grants to help the towns mitigate those fire hazards.
Before you leave that, one of the questions I have is there was a great problem with deforestation in Africa because of the use of open burning for cooking, and one of the projects that USAID was involved with was creating, using scrap material in order to make stoves, you know, like coffee cans, and also teaching them how to turn clay into an elemental oven. Is this in your rural areas? Is this something that you've seen as far as open fuel? Okay.
No, it's not a problem of rural area. It's a problem of urban areas because housing is becoming a high cost in Pakistan. So in order to make more colonies, more housing societies, deforestation is going on in northern parts of Pakistan. It's not for household use. It's just to clear the land and sell it for some other purposes.
Gotcha.
Being a coastal community, we have a large industry as well as large interest from homeowners in the marine sciences and shell fishing. And we work with all the town officials who manage shell fisheries as well as the private sector that have shellfish farms. We have 230 shellfish farms in the Cape, so it's a good sized industry. We have about 1,400 commercial fishermen, shell fishermen. So we work with them on habitat assessments, as well as managing the fishery, providing seed for the towns. We go out to bid, get the best price for quahog and oyster seeds. So we have public and private aquaculture.
Bill, do you know what a quahog is?
Sorry?
A quahog? Why don't you tell me what a quahog is?
A quahog is a hard clam, hard shell clam. You can make clams.
This is a...
That's an oyster.
That's right.
Well, it's on the idea of this.
Yeah. Yeah. You open
it up
in the it's a bivalve. It's a mollusk. It's in the phylum
mollusca. This was a nice gift given to me by someone.
So, and if you remember, my daughter Emily.
Yeah.
Emily works in oyster grant application, so you'll be visiting one of these accidents a week.
And be sure to have some cohort chowder, clam chowder.
Yeah, I hope you're treating them properly to the...
Everything's under control.
Okay, yeah.
In order to assist the municipalities, we have, and actually the private sector, we have 14 research farms in different water bodies around the Cape where we duplicate research projects. We find out what the questions are, and then we work with the different industries and municipalities on research projects. And monitor water quality. We have several sites around the Cape where we have water monitoring equipment that has real-time data 24/7 on all variety of parameters of water quality.
Here is the solar system working for
the solar one?
Yeah.
It's a, actually, some of our sites, not all of them, we're able to transmit the data to a satellite, and it comes back to our website. So you can see real live data. So where there's no power there, I think that's in Wellfleet. We're in Wellfleet, here in Barnstable, where there's no power, so we're using solar energy to run them. They're called Endico YSI, Water Quality Monitoring. It's an international company. And we have a...
It's burning toast.
The corpse.
That smells familiar.
I know. It's all hungry now. Start smelling food.
Since, again, we're a marine
lunchtime
influence on our environment, we have a coastal explorer. It's a 32 RV that is equipped as a laboratory and educational unit. And it goes to just about every elementary school in the Cape. And the person that runs this program teaches 5 marine classes a day to elementary children to further educate them about the importance of our marine communities here on the Cape. And we have an individual that works with coastal processes, shoreline change data, dune profiling, public education on all aspects of coastal processes. I think that does it. No, that's about it. All right, so happy to answer your questions if you have any.
I just add that sort of, Bill, on this one, like we have the staff entomologist working on the Lyme disease, the coastal process person, the towns alone, they couldn't afford to do that each individually. This is one where one entomologist, one coastal expert, for all the 15 towns, that's an efficiency that you gain, and you have that service available to do.
Given that we have a global economy now, we're seeing introduction of a lot of new invasive insects, for example. So the entomologists, in addition to working with ticks and the diseases they carry, just last year, through different monitoring sites, we picked up the presence of 2 new insects that are very economically valuable to our agricultural industry. There's a 2-spotted Drosophila that came from some of the Asian countries, and it's only been in the United States for 3 years. And it affects all soft-bodied fruit, like blueberries, strawberries, raspberries, and so we're monitoring those, working with growers to when to spray, what to spray, that type of thing. We have another insect called the brown marmorated stink bug that is devastating to vegetables. So we're keeping an eye on those, and again, working with growers and the public on how to manage those pests. So it's, and as well as a lot of tree insects that, you can trees make a difference in a community, and we start losing trees to insects, then it really makes a difference. So part of the strategy is to manage the insects that are there. The other part is to, when we lose trees, is to plant trees that are more sustainable.
What were the trees that were you lost in Worcester? Because I think they decimated most of the town of Worcester.
Yeah, boar beetle.
The boar beetle. The
Asian longhorn beetle.
Yeah.
And what tree did they attack?
Well, they affect maples.
Maple.
A lot of the hardwoods. Good news is they don't go after the oaks.
Yeah.
So if they were to come here, it would primarily affect the red maple swamps and so forth.
And we haven't even mentioned the, you know, the zebra mussels and the other, you know, things that come on ship bottoms.
Oh, yeah, we find a lot of invasive species. Yeah, I know you're going to move on.
No, that's okay.
Yeah, maybe Sean next?
Yeah, Sean next, because...
I know, he's been waiting a long time.
Poor Sean.
Johnny on the spot.
I asked him to come at 1:00, so...
Well, and I've got two things to go over. I've got both our departments with Barnstable County Department of Health and the Environment, and then also talk to you a little bit about what we do for emergency management and emergency preparedness. I do have a short presentation for the Regional Emergency Planning Committee. Let me just pop that in here, and...
You want me to do that while you start the other one, Sean?
Sure, you can do that. Oh, I got it.
So you can go to the... As you see, you know, we have this arm, you know, that we're out here. So it's really like one road as you coming to realize one major road through. That's it.
Okay. And don't be confused with the fact that the two parallel roads, one is marked east and west and the other is north and south.
Right.
You don't have to worry about that.
It took me about 8 years to figure it out, but I got it.
I'm the designated driver.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We are relying on Daddy.
Okay, we're right at the bottom here.
By the way, had you heard of Cape Cod before you came here? Because I was in Kuala Lumpur in a department store, and I remember how surprised I was to see the Cape Cod section, with the little pen and ink sketches and things like that that were in there. It was really amazing, you know, halfway around the world.
We heard about that, and we just came here and asked Charlie and Jill what Cape Cod is. Mm-hmm. Then they told us that it's the combination of 15 towns.
During the we came here and Rooster.
Yeah,
and
everyone's
talking
calling
about the Cape Cod.
What is that?
I don't know why they call it Cape Cod.
Yeah, and we're wondering about that too, because the cod is disappearing.
I know, but there used to be huge cod. Yes.
Yeah, all, see, it's part of our, this is our seal.
Yes.
Yeah, the sacred cod.
Yes,
the sacred cod.
They were massive when settlers first came.
Oh, you took her to a herring run?
Yeah.
Well, oh, awesome.
Yeah, Roxana was catching herring with her bare hands.
Was it the one by, Charlie, was it the one by my house or was it the other side of Long Pond?
See, you could team up with AmeriCorps and...
Was it the one by my house or was it the one on the other side of Long Pond?
No, the one at Brewster.
Okay.
Where the mill science is.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, Sean, you're on.
All right. Excellent. All right, well, thank you. And so I always like to talk about the fish. Yeah. We all like the fish. Again, my name is Sean O'Brien, and I am the Emergency Preparedness Coordinator for Barnstable County. I also, the program that I work with is based out of the Barnstable County Department of Health and Environment. We have been the county health department, as I mentioned earlier, we're the only county health department in New England. When you leave New England, you start to see different counties have a larger health role, but here on Cape Cod is kind of a unique thing for all of New England. We were formed by an act of Massachusetts legislation back in 1926. And back then, the reason why they put this health department together was really because something was needed for the 15 communities here on Cape Cod. The towns at the time and our population was a lot smaller. And so there needed to be something there for clean wells, clean food supplies, wastewater, etc., how to handle these things, and that's why the County Health Department was developed. As towns and our population has gotten bigger over the years, we've actually kind of stepped back from the day-to-day issues that town health departments now cover. In Brewster, you might have met Nancy Ellis Ice, who was the health agent. She does the everyday town health agent duties. She handles their Title V, she handles restaurant, sanitary code inspections, housing inspections, etc. Well, as we've developed over the years, what we do is we provide a lot of support functions for those health departments in areas that they may not be able to do themselves. So we look at a lot of the different regional projects that may be out there. We have a staff of about 20 people. And each one of us, we have just a wide range of functions within there. We have a comprehensive water analysis laboratory that we test just about every beach here in Barnstable County, whether it be a saltwater beach or a freshwater beach. We test water supplies, whether it be private wells like we have on the Outer Cape, or whether it be a public water supply like the town of Brewster or the town of Falmouth has. Additionally, we also do work around waste sites and hazardous waste sites. So we do groundwater monitoring for them. And that's just if there has been a history of a problem with an environmental release, say a hazardous material was released. Our laboratory is able to do a lot of the analysis to see how clean is the water around that area. And it actually leads into a lot of different things that are happening here in Cape now. Like in the town of Eastham, they're looking at a public water supply. A lot of the analysis that's been done in that area has been conducted by our laboratory and samples collected by our staff. We are a public health department and an environmental department at the same time. For public health, we're able to provide nursing services. We have a very active immunization program within the county. Deidre Arvidsson, who's our public health nurse, has a great program where she actually prioritizes making sure our first responders get flu vaccinations every year or have tuberculosis tests done in order to make sure that they're fit for duty, they're able to continue on, and should there ever be an emergency, they're ready to go. We also have an environmental health and service program, health and safety program, excuse me. Marina Brock, who is with our office, does a lot of work with local departments of public works. We try to see where the hazards might be in their job environment, where air quality issues may be within town buildings, and we try to help the communities solve those. We have a very active program with our staff where we do sanitary code inspections. If a town needs help, we're there. We do it. Every summer, we hire 3 inspectors to go out and to inspect all of the restaurants here in Barnstable County to support our 15 communities. What we also do is we hire beach samplers every year, which is the best job in the world. They pay you to go to the beach, okay? And you can go out and collect a water, and you go out and you collect a water sample and bring it back to our laboratory. Those beaches must meet minimum standards for cleanliness. Water quality standards must be met. So what we do is we weekly test these beaches, and those samples come into our laboratory. And we make sure that we get results out right away. And unfortunately, there are times that we do have to retest a beach, or we may have to close it for a little while until water quality gets better. Very rare, but we occasionally have to do it. Because we're such a seasonal area, but we're also a very tourist-based area, it's important for us to have this program. And these are all things that fall under Massachusetts public health law, Mass General Laws under public health.
And let me just add, Sean, sort of that's a good illustration of one of these issues that sometimes we face is called these unfunded mandates. Either the feds or usually the state will say, you must do something. And they're usually saying to the local community, local town, you must do something. And in this case, it's you must monitor your beaches. You have to test them in the summer before people can swim at them. So one of the areas sort of that we've done very successfully is sort of these little niche areas where there's a mandate that the town by itself couldn't do. We sort of step in and we've done it for them on their behalf. We don't charge them any fees for those. So.
Yeah, I think there's a laboratory cost, and I think it goes through the Commonwealth, right. The Commonwealth of Massachusetts, as it moves forward. We also have a very active tobacco program. We have a group within our department, and what their goal is to make sure that number one, if people want to quit smoking, those resources are available. Number two, if we want to make sure that cigarettes and tobacco products like those are not sold to minors, and so they actually make sure that all shops, stores, etc., are in compliance with these tobacco regulations, again from the state, where we want to make sure our children are not partaking in tobacco products. And so they go out, they do inspections. They also provide services to the community. So if somebody is a smoker and they want to quit, we can put them into contact with folks that can help them, you know, help them change and work that way. We also are involved with wastewater. It's kind of interesting because all of our different departments are involved in wastewater. And so for us, a lot of times what we do is we go out and we support the towns when they deal with their on-site wastewater issues. And probably first and foremost, we are able to do their septic plan review if they need help with it. We can do soil tests, which is making sure the soil can hold a wastewater system. But then what we also do is we operate a septic system test center. And it's a unique, it's probably the only one like it in the United States. There are some clean water facilities that are out there, and I think Texas A&M is starting to open up a facility where they do test with waste. But we look at the potentials of using green systems or of using alternative wastewater systems, things that are better for our environment down here. So we do have a research component to our department. We also have a septic system loan program as well. Should folks in Barnstable County need a little help when it comes to replacing a septic system in their backyard, we have that ability through our department to make loans. And we have a division of our department that provides, I think, annually up to $10 million in loans to the public. So if they need to have a replacement done, and it covers everything that they may need, it's a low interest loan. So it's something where as they pay it back, it puts more money back into the fund so we can loan more money out the next year. And it's been a very successful program. And then lastly, what we do, well, not lastly, because there are a lot of different things that we do, but there's also the project that I work on, and that's the Barnstable County Regional Emergency Planning Committee. We were formed back in 2001. We had a very significant thing happening here in Barnstable County, but all of the country, and that was there was an anthrax scare. And we had concerns regarding our mail. Mail laced with anthrax was sent out to our federal Capitol building. And our local fire chiefs said, hey, wait a minute. You know, we really need to consider these issues for our county, and we need to plan for different types of emergencies for Barnstable County. The weekend of October 12th, there were about 150 hazmat or hazardous materials calls here in southeastern Massachusetts, and many of them were on Cape Cod. So our fire chiefs looked at this and they said, hey, we need to look at getting together and starting to meet and discuss emergency management and emergency planning issues. So they asked us to form this thing called an LEPC, a Local Emergency Planning Committee. And I'm going to go through this a little quick. We looked and we said, what is a Local Emergency Planning Committee? Well, it's a group of folks that sit down, and it's actually a federal mandate under a federal regulation called the Emergency Planning Community Right to Know Act. And what this federal requirement does is it says to communities, you need to meet, you need to get a group of folks together, you need to come up with a hazardous materials response plan, and you need to keep track of all of your hazardous materials that are within your county. And it's interesting because this is a federal law that came about from an incident that happened in India. From what happened at the Bhopal Union Carbide.
Yeah.
And basically what had happened was our federal government saw this and they said, you know, if you live in a community, you have a right to know what hazardous materials are in your community. And that's what got us sitting down and working together. So it's kind of interesting because first and foremost, we were formed as a hazardous materials group. And we still do quite a bit. We have about 345 Tier 2 reporters here in Barnstable County. We besides identifying who we have for hazardous materials users, we also need to write a regional hazmat plan. We need to have this local emergency planning committee, and we call it a regional emergency planning committee, the Barnstable County Regional Emergency Planning Committee. We have to have emergency notification, and we also need to maintain our inventories should there ever be a problem. And we also conduct exercises every year of simulated hazmat spills. And so originally we were formed to deal with hazardous materials. And these are all the communities that participate with us. Now, besides having the 15 communities of Barnstable County working with us, we also have the island of Nantucket. So we are a multi-county, we have multi-county jurisdiction on this committee. We also have our Air Force base, our Air National Guard base involved with us at the Massachusetts Military Reservation. And what happens is we have about 2,000 people that live on the base. So we treat the base, our military reservation, also as a community with our emergency planning. The other thing too is they're one of the larger hazardous materials users in the county, so we want to keep, we have a pretty good working relationship with them. There's a whole application process that we have to go through, and this is the building we're in right now, but we can't do this, and we can't do these things without the support of these folks up here, our commissioners and our county administrator. What the commissioners over the years have done, have asked us to continue on with our certifications and have assisted us with our appointments and given us the support that we need in order to carry this out. And we use these meetings as ways for our group to get together. We have about 40, 50 people that meet monthly. And what's interesting is we use it now not only as a hazardous materials committee, but we use it as an all-hazard committee. And what I mean by all-hazard is we look at all types of emergencies and disasters that we may have to work with. Example would be, this past year, we had a really significant blizzard come through the area. We saw power outages in part of Cape Cod here for up to 6 days as a part of it. And one of the difficult things that happened with this blizzard was temperatures dropped very low very quickly. So people didn't have power and they also didn't have heat. And so our goal has been to get these groups, we saw this, we met, and how do we solve these situations with power outages, but also with sheltering. And we have six, we don't do shelters on a local level. We do it regionally. Oops. And then just these are some of the committees that we have. Our committee is actually is organized by through both police and fire departments. Our chair is a fire chief. Our vice chair is a police chief. Those here on Cape Cod, they are our public safety agencies work really well together. I think today you met, was it Charlie's boss, Chief Coke.
They know that too.
Yeah, I know. I actually talked to Chief Coke on the phone today.
Is he an improvement or over Roy? What do you think?
And you have your fire chief as well, Chief Moran. And you can tell they work really well together. And it's like that across the Cape. Everybody works really, really well together, and it allows us to plan together as well. And just these are some of the agencies that work with us: Cape Cod Healthcare, the Community College, Cape Cod Commission is a member. We have folks from the Resource Development Office that participate with us. But also we have, it's no longer the fighter wing, it's now an intelligence wing, but we work with the military, we work with a lot of different municipal agencies, we work with our Sheriff's Department. And so these are just some of the things that we do. We work on hazardous materials management, as we talked about. We also work on mutual aid, which is communities helping communities in times of emergencies. On a summer's day, you may have an ambulance call in the town of Brewster, but an ambulance may be closer in Harwich, and they may respond. And that's all part of our mutual aid system. It's a great way where we all work together as a community, and the great thing is we're the envy of the state. We plan for weather events. If there's a storm or a hurricane or a blizzard, we actually handle everything regionally. Each town has its own emergency manager, and then they support. They support and they work with us, or we support them, with a multi-agency coordination center. So if we need to bring any resources onto the Cape, if we need to bring food supplies onto the Cape, we need to prioritize power, we do it regionally. We have six regional shelters here in the county. We do not do sheltering anymore on a town-by-town basis unless it's a localized emergency. We do it regionally. We do a lot of grant writing. We do a lot of preparing for public health emergencies, and we also support local incidents. I just want to take, and I'll probably end on this because it goes back to the whole health department thing. One of the things that we do is we work very extensively with our health agents on planning for communicable disease emergencies. As we saw back in 2010, we had a very high incidence rate of H1N1 influenza that had come into the country. And as a response to that, we also saw a very low rate of vaccine production that year. So we worked with all 15 communities on prioritizing vaccinations, whether it be for folks over 65 years of age, whether it be for children, or emergency responders. And we plan for these types of emergencies with our health agents as well. And we want to make sure that we're prepared. Should we see something like, you know, something that we may not have never seen before, whether it be a different type of flu, whether it be something from the past like smallpox or whatever, or cholera, whatever the concern may be, we're prepared for it. And then probably the thing we prepare the most for is actually influenza. And on that, I will open it up.
Questions? Covered a lot of territory. See, all of this stuff
sort of washes over you.
I know, it's time
for a break. Well, we have one more. Yeah. Thank you, Sean.
Thank you.
AmeriCorps.
Catherine, thank
yes.
you. She stuck it out.
Yeah,
I appreciate
she held
that
out
much.
To the
Sorry
bitter
I
end.
I had a member with me, but she
I had to go.
Had to go.
I know.
Yes. And I feel
well,
very I feel very unprepared because I don't have a presentation.
No, that's all right.
It's probably better.
Thank you for coming to visit us. My name is Catherine Garofoli. I currently work at the Barnstable County Resource Development Office as a resource development officer. And part of my role is to do some community development and program development with municipalities and county departments. I identify funding opportunities for these projects and provide assistance to write grant applications to hopefully obtain the funding to see these programs through. And a lot of the programs that you heard today, my department has helped to implement some funding for them to make these things happen. So another part of the Resource Development Office is to provide oversight to our very successful AmeriCorps Cape Cod program. And AmeriCorps Cape Cod is on its 14th year. It is a volunteer service organization, if you will. We currently have 29 members, young adults, coming to Cape Cod and providing volunteer service for 11 months. And I actually am an alumni. I was here in year, oh gosh, 8. So that was 7 years ago, which is really crazy to think about.
Yeah, it is.
I know. So basically, the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program is like a domestic Peace Corps, if you're familiar with the Peace Corps. And there are four core areas, natural resource management, disaster preparedness and response, community education, and volunteer engagement. And some of those things include, under natural resource management, removing invasive species, such as a bittersweet and under disaster preparedness, we go out into the community and provide opportunities to educate the people how to prepare themselves in a disaster situation. We also, our members, go out and help operate shelters in the event of a blizzard like Sean was describing earlier that we experienced this year. Our members were manning shelters for up to 72 hours that entire time and providing critical services to citizens that were very much in distress.
And then I have to say, because during that, it was Nemo, right? That was
Nemo.
Nemo.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. These guys were crucial to that. Otherwise, we wouldn't have had enough volunteers to man mm-hmm. the shelters. So the AmeriCorps kids, we always call them kids, but you're right, they're young adults. they were crucial to that. I can't stress that enough.
And they're all college graduates.
Yes, and they come from all over the United States. There are a number of Cape Cod natives that come and serve in AmeriCorps. But I myself came, I grew up in a very small town in Massachusetts, and I came here to provide this type of service. And this year, we're very excited that we have a few international candidates that want to come in and take part in this program. So that's very exciting for us. We will be, I'm sorry, let me back up. So another part of our mission is to provide volunteer engagement. AmeriCorps Cape Cod has a number of signature events that we bring to the community, one of them being Martin Luther King Day, Day of Service. And then we have AmeriCorps Week, which this year we're partnering with the town of Mashpee to do a number of natural resource management and education projects. We have over 120 community partners, whether it's a municipality, the county itself, and a number of nonprofit organizations that we worked very closely with to identify the needs of the community and implement projects that will better our very amazing place that we live in. And just speaking from personal experience, AmeriCorps to me was a life changer. It was amazing. I came in and it was in a very interesting point in my life, and I was able to make connections with a variety of different people across the community and find my way in and really feel a sense of home. And that's the other part of AmeriCorps, is providing these young adults with a sense of self and a civic engagement. And we're really trying hard to foster their growth as well as the community itself.
Many of the kids that have come through AmeriCorps have stayed here, and they've developed and they've worked their way to be working for the different towns in capacities. And one of the issues here is that 34% of us are over 55, and although they provide a volunteer base, one of the problems is that they have winter residents, and they're not here during some of these snow emergencies. So AmeriCorps, being a year-round activity, has been very crucial. The other part is the Chamber of Commerce and others have bemoaned the fact that we lose our young people after they're educated. And I think everybody grows up, goes away, and comes home. But our folks, our kids, have been going away and not coming back. And so that's another issue of how to retain and have more of a diversity in ages, you know, in the Cape, because otherwise we're just an old folks home.
Right.
Well, something else that's very important to mention, the AmeriCorps Cape Cod program is jointly funded by Barnstable County, portion by the Cape Cod National Seashore, which is a federal entity, and also through the Corporation of National Community Service, which is also a federal agency. And all of those funding sources allow our members to go out into the community free of charge, voluntarily, to provide these critical this critical work. So
you get your members all from different corners of the country and from the world. Do you provide them any accommodation, food, and other?
Oh, yes, we do. We have three houses that the members reside at, one in Bourne, which is closer to the two bridges, and then one at two out in Wellfleet. Both of them are on the Park Service land. So a portion of Cape Cod is protected by the National Park Service.
And we think we're the only AmeriCorps program that provides housing for the volunteers.
Residential
Most of them
program is fairly
have
unique.
To find their own places to live, but not here.
Or they're within the community. One of the biggest programs, I don't know if you've heard of it, it's in Boston, it's called City Year.
Mm-hmm.
But all those kids live at home, I assume. There's not a residential
program. Provide them with a small living stipend. Our members receive a very small stipend, and it qualifies them for some food resources, whether that be food stamps and access to food pantries and things like that. But other than that, they're able to reside here at no cost.
And at the end of the program,
do you advertise for getting services of these volunteers?
It's done through the universities.
Okay.
Universities offer it as exit. Am I correct? Did you learn about it through your university?
No, I didn't.
Oh, I'm sorry.
We use a number of different recruitment methods. We advertise it through university job fairs. We also advertise it on Idealist. It's a nonprofit kind of forum. Some of the more local job listings, like in the paper, and through the community college, because we do like to recruit native Cape Codders, but for the most part, we just blast it out there. It's also on the national website for community service.
Okay.
Actually, I have a question. So how competitive has it become?
It has become very competitive. We have technically 32 openings. We have 26 general core members, and then 6 additional members for a new initiative that we started for wildfire mitigation. Bill was talking earlier about the issue of how Cape Cod is so susceptible to wildfires. So we started to partner with the National Seashore to dedicate 6 members to address wildfire mitigation, like cutting areas back that could be potential hazards for wildfire, create wildfire, starting.
So for those 32, how many applicants do you get?
That's a really good question.
Hundreds? Thousands?
No, not thousands. But it's pretty competitive. I would say definitely 100. I'm not really part in the recruitment.
Yeah, right.
But I know that there have been a number of applications that have come in that are very well qualified, and it's really fantastic.
What do you mean by well qualified? Are they involved in community services, or do they have any background of such?
Well, that's a good question. So we ask that the members have a college degree or some form of college education, and that they have experience with community service and or AmeriCorps service specifically. So they should have a general sense of civic engagement.
And hard work.
Yeah.
High schools, private and public high schools locally have been moving towards having more community service integrated into their curriculum.
Yeah, it's because, almost part of the requirement now. You really have to do something.
And you're living in an area, or we live in an area around Boston, 30 universities, you know, that are you know, within walking distance, let's say, of Boston. So it's an area rich in, you know, in, let's say, in things that would attract, you know, someone of that age. Of course, down here, the complaint of people, you know, for age has nothing to do. You know, we have to find something else.
So Pat, we the next.
I take my.
Any other questions?
Pat, we have something.
Mary Mitchie has a question.
Some a little more detail about the disaster management. As do you have any post-crisis need-based assessment program for that?
That's a really good question. We rely on organizations like the Barnstable County Regional Emergency Planning Committee and the American Red Cross, who is also a partner of ours, to identify the needs that the members should address. We do have a number of members that have their own initiatives that they like to start. Part of the, when members come in, we train them for a month before they start going out into the community and actually doing direct service. And part of that is training them on shelter operations, volunteer management regarding the shelters, and
chainsaw training.
It's a little bit tricky, but our members respond to dolphin stranding as well, because Cape Cod is, Wellfleet specifically, is a very big hotspot for mammal strandings, marine mammal strandings, and our members are trained for that, to respond to that. So it really varies year by year. This year we've had a high number of events that our members have responded to. I don't know if you have heard about Hurricane Sandy. It impacted the Northeast very much so. And a number of our members actually went out to New York, where it was impacted the most, and provided service there to clean up trees that were down. And it really varies year by year.
Thank you.
Yes, very much.
We have a present.
Yes. So you've got a thumbnail sketch before we put you to sleep. It was getting to be long, but it was very thorough. And it still wasn't everything. We have a human service department. We have other departments that you haven't known, but we can give you an idea.
And we have a gift bag for you to take back with you.
Oh, excellent.
Over here.
Do I get one too?
Actually, there is one for you, Charlie, and there is one for Sue. So there you go. It's just have a little token of your visit to Barnstable County. And, it's because it doesn't have the list on back. But Sue can, or Charlie can.
Yeah, I was kidding, but that's great.
Yes, Charlie gets one too.
Good.
I think so.
Or maybe all that information.
Yeah. I hope it's not over $50 in value.
Yeah. No,
it's priceless.
Yes, Charlie.
Okay. We do have formal vote of thanks when we were visiting in the form of a group of 14 people.
But right now, we are only three members, so on behalf of all my two friends and one Charlie, I would like to thank you for inviting us here. While we were coming over there, we just read that this is commissioner's meeting. We were a bit confused because commissioner on our side is in charge of a big administrative unit or in charge of taxation department. So we thought there must be very, very high commissioner people and some chief commissioner will be presiding over the meeting. Yeah, exactly. But we are very glad to hear all that. We were able to speak our mind and we were able to listen to lots of information that we are trying to absorb.
Well, we're very informal here, so I appreciate that. But they really are in charge of what is essentially a $25 million operation. We have about total 250 employees, so.
Yeah, that's seasonal. But,
we're just
completely,
yeah. Yeah, full-time is 179.
But it was really delightful to have you here today and have an opportunity to exchange information. It's been great.
Thank you. So nice of you. And these gifts are totally unexpected because we are trying to bring gifts from Pakistan for our host.
Yes.
But we never knew we would be
having return gifts as well.
Well, you know what you call these in America? You call them a swag bag.
Oh, so, swag bag.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
And if I could, I'd like to thank the commissioners and Mark and the staff for providing this opportunity to educate us. And I do want to thank the commissioners and Mark because really, you know, I've talked a little about this, but we can only do so much at the local level. And having partners, regional partners that can help us do things better, more cost in a cost-effective manner, is really a key issue. And I think that's what I think you can see the cooperation between officials because I think we're all trying to find ways to do things better, more economically, and more efficiently. And that's really what's going on here. But in closing, the selectmen from the town of Brewster did sign all of the agreements on Monday evening to build the large solar complex up in Freeman's Way off Commerce Park. And I just want to thank Mark and Maggie. And I know they work for you, and I know you fund and allow them to work on behalf of the towns, but 100% of the power needs for all of Brewster's town and school buildings will be provided through this project in round one, which is the landfill. And we never would have been able to carry out this project without the assistance of Mark and Maggie and CVEC and Cape Light Compact and really the commissioners. So that's one thing of many things that you do for us. But I really want, our guests were at the selectmen's meeting when we executed this final agreement.
Oh, good.
But it's been, you think about it, 4 years of work.
Well, I appreciate your help too, Charlie. You guys have been very supportive.
This is where you learn that politics is like pushing a string.
Yeah, but I do appreciate everything.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you, Charlie.
We're glad you came to visit.
And, you know, we kid Charlie a lot because we have a good rapport, but he's one of the, he's actually the dean of town managers now at Cape Cod.
He's the longest serving, presently serving.
They like Cindy better than they like
me. Oh, yeah. I don't know, but it would be a hard choice between the two.
Other regional agency you might want to see would be the RTA. You might want to call Tommy Gahair and see if, you know.
We have a lot going on. Okay.
Great. Well, we're just going to take a little break and if you're on your way and thank everybody who came and thank you very much.
Thank you.
And wish you well on your way and the rest of your visit here.
You know, one of the things that I found over the years, whenever I travel, I always find that where I went, they knew more about America than I knew about them.
After a lovely 2-hour discussion with our visitors from Pakistan, and so we want to move to our agenda item, which is approval of the summary of items. They are in the area of finance, contracts, bid awards, and then some for the chair only that relate to septic management or betterments. So a motion to approve?
I make that motion to approve.
Second. Those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? None opposed? Unanimous. And we also have the minutes of minutes of April 20.
And I did look at the.
I did too. I can't find them. See if they're in there. There they are. Yeah. No, that's. Look in the purple folder. No, the blue folder, I'm sorry. It should be right up front. Oh, Bill's been through it.
Yeah.
What was last Wednesday?
Last Wednesday was the 24th.
So the minutes of the 24th. So you want to make a motion?
I will make a motion that we approve the minutes.
And I'll second. And all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye, opposed, unanimous. Anything else to come before the board, Mark?
I just want to note that we have, you know, as you know, we started the IT review.
Right.
And last Monday, a week ago this Monday, we did the workshop sessions, which were very well received. Shelton came down and he had a morning session and an afternoon session. Monday, he did the interview with me, which lasted till about 1:30, so it was pretty extensive. And yesterday, he was up with IT, working, interviewing the staff up there. And today, he was with IT as well. So next Wednesday, the 8th, he's scheduled to meet individually with each of you guys to do your interviews. And so right now, he has three blocks. He has 8:30 to 9:30, 9:30, 10:30, and 10:30, 11:30. He's got you at 8:30, if that's okay.
Next Wednesday?
Next Wednesday. He's got Bill at 9:30, and he's got Sheila at 10:30, if that's possible.
Give me a little time in the morning.
And we'll do it here.
Okay.
And we'll do it in your, in the commissioner's office.
Okay.
So that'll be at 8:30?
Yeah.
Do we have a meeting next week?
Yeah.
Meeting?
I don't have specifically anything on the agenda, but, because I knew we would have that.
Well, we may, based on the assembly today.
It will, and also there is a...
You know, so we should probably post a meet. We probably will not have to meet on the 29th, because there's five Wednesdays in May.
Right.
So we could probably not meet the 29th.
Yes, and we want to discuss...
Oh, wait a minute, what about Memorial Day?
...for next week.
What?
The resolution.
Why, we already, it's already gone over.
Okay.
The disapproval, yeah.
Yeah, the disapproval, yes.
We actually have copies of that.
I'm talking about what we discussed with in strategic planning, or responsibility both, when we had come over that.
Oh, okay, so we'll put that on.
Yeah, would you?
Yeah.
So next week...
We have strategic planning tomorrow, right?
We have strategic planning on Monday at 1:00, and it's in the downstairs conference room.
I saw that, yeah. So 1:00 Monday.
1:00 on Monday.
Okay. And then we'll figure out what we're going to do on Wednesday.
Yeah, I mean, we could, so you have an 8:30, 9:30, 9:30, 10:30, 10:30, 11:30.
So maybe we could just meet, well, the assembly's not meeting, so maybe we could meet at, what, noon?
Doesn't matter, yeah, we can just...
We could just meet at noon and do our regular business. How's that?
Sounds great.
Not try to rush things.
And yeah, depending on what the assembly does, we'll either have to talk about something or not have to talk about something.
Right.
Well, we'll have to do something, one way or the other.
We'll have to do something after today, there's no question about it, so we do need to meet. All right.
And then the 15th, I figure we will meet in the afternoon sometime, and...
There's a hearing, it's in Boston at 2:00 that day, the hearing on the recall.
Oh.
The hearing on the recall is at 2:00.
I was going to have the auditors come in, because, to do that, because they're going to do the assembly.
I suppose we don't really have to go to that, do we? Should somebody be there? I mean, somebody should, or maybe we could just provide written testimony.
Maybe we could do that, let me work on something for that.
All right, let's think about that. All right, so let's put a...
For the 15th.
A meeting on then for what, 1:00?
I think I just talked to Chris Rogers, I think he's meeting with the assembly at 3:00, so maybe he could meet with you guys at 2:00 and then go right over to the assembly, so, and we wouldn't have much else than that, other than that.
Okay.
Then I do want to do a lab tour, so that we can go up and see the new lab space before they start moving in, just so you get a feel for it.
Okay.
For a couple of weeks after that.
So next week, we're each meeting with the IT.
IT, Sheldon, yep, meeting with Sheldon.
And then we're going to meet at noon.
Then we'll meet, because we'll have the budget on the agenda, the ordinance will be on the agenda.
From whatever happens today. So we've got that, and then we still have the meeting on the 22nd.
Yeah, maybe we do the lab tour on the 22nd.
Yeah, and then we won't meet on the 29th.
That sounds good.
Okay, motion to adjourn?
Have you had the vote?
Yeah, we just did everything.
They did, I just said you stepped out.
Second? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.